infrastructure across Asia, 56% of the gap is towards energy and 32% for transport. In other words, 88%, pretty much 90% of all infrastructure needs are in energy and transport. Now, on energy, the models to take energy the renewable route are more than established. Those are proven, those are commercially viable, and all the energy capacities coming up now are in the renewable space. Therefore, the risk of assets getting locked into high greenhouse gas emitting solutions is not there. In transport, likewise, urban transport is going to attract a lot of the investment, and urban transport will be based on metro rail, bus rapid transit corridors, and electric vehicles. So, I think the risk of locking into assets with a high carbon footprint are not there. Now, the only other question could be whether these assets would be generating enough revenue to be commercially viable. And now, there we feel that the commodities that these assets will create are absolutely inelastic. And also, today tariffs have fallen to a level where renewable energy is matching conventional fossil fuel generation expenses. So, therefore, I think the question of locking into assets which are not generating enough revenue is not there either. Now, in some cases, the government may have to regulate or legislate to some extent, and that will be for specific governments to do. Emerging Asia needs a huge amount of capital for infrastructure, 26 trillion up to 2030. Now, to mobilize that kind of money, we need to catalyze several forms of finance. Much of this has to come from the public sector. The report that ADB is launching today talks about frameworks that will be able to catalyze this large amount or pool of capital. Now, catalyzing capital is one thing, but utilizing the catalyzed capital also requires certain other skills. So, why would private capital get in if there are no returns, if there is no enabling framework which gives them confidence that they should invest? So, I think collaborating with governments for developing frameworks, and also collaborating on best practices, knowledge development will be important, and ADB proposes to do that. We call it catalyzing plus plus or finance plus plus, where technology innovation, implementation effectiveness, and management efficiencies will need to be mainstreamed to make it attractive for the private sector to come in as we try to catalyze more funds. You know, we all believe somewhere that no matter what we do, no matter what our profession or our calling, all of us want eventually to be happy. We all work for happiness. One of the important aspects of that happiness is that you should leave behind a world which is better than the one that you inherited. And I think green finance ties in perfectly with that sentiment. The fact is that natural resources are a commodity which is fast depleting and will not be able to sustain the kind of devastation and overuse that current technologies and populations are doing. And therefore, we must green all finance going forward. In other words, the cost of preserving natural resources has to be factored into all projects.